I'd never get to drive.
Honda, we make it simple.
Though you wouldn't know it from that old photo, Bette Davis is 71 and still working and still the opinionated lady she was when she was the Empress of Hollywood. I do not regret one professional enemy I have made, says the redoubtable Miss Davis. And if you aim high, the pygmies will jump on your back and tug at your skirts. Or from this Yankee Puritan, a good percentage of our lives is spent doing things we loathe. Marvelous. It puts starch in your spine. Well, Bette Davis recently deserted the East Coast, where she had lived for many years, and moved west again to Hollywood, the scene of her old triumphs and her old battles. Among the triumphs, two Oscars. She had 10 Academy Award nominations. Among her battles, her famous losing fight with Warner Brothers that ended in the courts after she'd gone on strike. It was in Hollywood that we sat down with her to canvas her current views on politics and passion, men and women, money and work. We begin with a grainy glimpse of one of her first Warner Brothers pictures.
I'm giving a party too. A big one.
In 1932, Bette Davis appeared in no less than 9 films.
I want you to come and be my boyfriend.
In this one, over the strong opposition of director Michael Curtiz, who thought she was unsexy, she was cast as a conniving vixen, the role that would eventually become her trademark.
Cute. I'd like to kiss you, but I just washed my hair.
I'd love to kiss you, but I just washed my hair.
That's right.
My favorite line in any movie I ever had. Mr. Curtiz was so against my playing this kind of a part, because he said, that's the unsexiest looking woman I have ever seen in my life.
Well, Mr. Curtiz
and
is
Mr.
wrong.
And Mr. Barthelmess wouldn't even test with me. So I had to end up kissing the lens like this. Boy, every scene I played in that, he said, goddamn lousy actress. Goddamn, behind the camera. Mm-hmm. They never really understood that there was something very peculiar about me and that they could use it.
It may just have been that you were difficult, Betty.
No.
Not no. Difficult, impossible.
With a stupid director. Then it was self-preservation. It was absolutely self-preservation.
Yeah, but before the director had to be the producer, had to be the choice of script, had to be... I mean, come on, you had a reputation for being a first-class stubborn mule.
About scripts and bad directors. Those were the two.
And apparently with good reason. This was one of the epics Warner Brothers put her in back in 1936. It was after this abomination that she left Warner's and went on strike. She simply refused to do more films like this.
Listen, I know I have no right to ask you to help me, but I might be able to pay for it.
I got the $500 we've been talking about.
Did you? Get going, Mr. Shane. Your taxi's ticking.
Bette Davis had trouble not just with on-screen lovers and off-screen executives. She went through tempest at home, too. Miss Davis has had 4 husbands. First, bandleader Ham Nelson. 5 years of marriage, then divorce.
Ham, of course, was just, I outgrew him.
Yes.
I got older.
Then Arthur Farnsworth, businessman. 2 years, and he died.
The lovely, lovely guy died, you know, Farnie.
I know.
This would have worked. This would really have worked. He had no jealousy of me. He was had a damn good job himself at Disney's. He was Yankee.
Third, William Sherry, a painter. 6 difficult years and out.
Sherry beat you.
Yeah. Believe me.
Really beat you out?
I had this marvelous doctor in Laguna Beach, and after about taking care of me for 15 years or so, he said, I've got to ask you something. How could any bright woman like you marry the men you did?
And finally, Gary Merrill, 10 years, ending back in 1960 in divorce. That was her last try.
Why in the world did you marry Gary Merrill? 4th time around, so you're hardly a novice. He's an actor. You shouldn't have married an actor.
I never would. I think I decided, because I love marriage. I believe in marriage. I think a woman by herself is a perfectly asinine way to live.
Also, you believe that in order to go to bed with a fella, you've got to marry him, or at least you believe
that. Yes, I was. I was brought up absolutely no hidden corners.
Were you 26 years old
when I married him?
And you were.
I was a virgin.
You were chaste.
Mm-hmm.
At the time.
I was chaste.
At the age of 26.
Mm-hmm. He was a fool. I'd known him since I was 16 years old in prep school.
So if you love a fella, and you.
But my mother, I blame deeply for this. I blame. See, I am so for the change in the morals today. I really am. Because that is not a reason to marry.
To go to bed?
No, that is not a reason to marry. That is a ridiculous reason.
And then, in your compulsion to work, in your devotion to your career, and your mother's devotion to your career, you aborted your first child?
Two.
Two?
He begged me to. I did what he wanted.
This was with Nelson.
He did. My first husband, he did me a great favor, really. If I had had children that young, it's very possible I would have chosen the children to bring up. And I'm fortunate. Because at this age, had I never tried to do what I wanted to do, I'd be a pretty disappointed woman.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
In All About Eve, Bette Davis played the role of the actress Margot Channing. And people who knew her thought the character struck close to home.
Funny business, a woman's career. The things you drop on your way up the ladder so you can move faster. You forget you'll need them again when you get back to being a woman. It's one career all females have in common, whether we like it or not. Being a woman. Sooner or later, we've got to work at it. No matter how many other careers we've had or wanted. And in the last analysis, nothing's any good unless you can look up just before dinner or turn around in bed. And there he is. Without that, you're not a woman. You're something with a French provincial office or a book full of clippings.
But Bette Davis has more than a book full of clippings. She has three children. One of them, her daughter by William Sherry, Barbara Davis Hyman, known as Beatty, lives on a farm in Pennsylvania with her husband Jeremy and their two youngsters, Ashley and Justin. Beatty adores her mother, though she is candid about her.
Was she a tough mother?
In certain ways.
What ways?
Discipline, manners. It was worth your life to forget a please or a thank you. She was always very, very concerned with Hollywood being a place, not a way of life. And she worked very hard at that. She worked very hard to have a home in Maine, which was way out in the country on the seacoast, and to bring us up in the country.
Was your mother a star at home?
No, never, never. She was in blue jeans and work shirts, and she was a working mother when she was at home. She was in the kitchen. She was tidying up the house. She was weeding her garden, planting bulbs. She was a mother.
You're making this sound like a storybook.
No.
Well, we had our arguments.
We certainly did.
You wrote, if you've never been hated by your child, you have never been a parent.
You sure haven't. You've got to be hated sometimes. I think that is another thing that is going on today. I think parents are afraid of their children. They're so overzealous about being loved every minute.
And by the same token, now you do not use your kids as crutches for yourself.
No.
You got your life, they got theirs.
That's the hardest thing you have to learn to do.
Oh, boy.
I shouldn't have to tell you. Because you really, when the house is empty of children, it takes a few years.
Her adopted son, Michael Merrill, is an enterprising young attorney in Boston.
When you would see, as you were growing up, as you were a youngster, and you'd see your mother up there on the screen, what was the reaction?
Well, it's kind of hard to say. It's a difficult thing to see your mother on the screen, especially in the different roles. I could say that was difficult because in the one moment, here she is, your mother, walking around the house, cooking your meals and everything, and there she is playing some glamorous lady in a movie.
George!
Fanny!
George, darling!
Fanny!
But as I grew older, you know, there's no problem. I saw it as her job, and and I realized how good she was at it.
And then there is Margot.
Margot, your dear...
My darling Margot is still, you know, about 6 years old.
Really? And she's 20?
28.
Adopted. Tragedy?
Horrible. It was horrible. When a brain-injured child gets much, much older, it's different, fortunately. It levels off a bit, but it was terrible. My mother said, send her back. I said, would I have sent Beattie back? I made a deal. And actually, Margot's had a great life due to the fact I could afford to have her in a beautiful school.
Mm-hmm. You see her?
Oh, yes. I've for 20-some years, she spent every summer with me and every Christmas.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, what are your vices?
Always blaming myself for anything that happens. Terrific guilt. Guilt. Terrible.
Puritan New England. Mm-hmm. But also, your lack of vanity, your honesty, permits you to play, don't get angry, frumps.
Yeah, I'll play anything. But you see, that was my basic theory about acting, that the appearance should not be the reason you choose a part. The only time my daughter ever said to me, Mother, you have finally gone too far, wasn't Jane.
Whatever happened to baby Jane? Why? Do you need the money, or do you need the work, or do you need...
I need the work.
You really said, Betty, it has been my experience that one cannot in any shape or form depend on human relations for any lasting reward. It is only work that truly satisfies?
Yes, that stands by you. It isn't that many people don't add a great deal to your life. But I'm talking about as a permanent thing. That's the least disappointing relationship you can have.
It's work.
An old friend of Davis from New York and Hollywood both was the late Joan Blondell, who lived in Santa Monica. They used to work together.
She's 71. Why do you think that she came back here, this Maine girl, this New England Puritan, to Lotus Land at the age of 71?
I think that when you crash into the 70s, boy, you better do something exciting. Whatever's left, you know, and that's left to come here and... I think it was a good idea for her to do. Action and work comes from here, and I think it'll open up a whole new career for her now.
Was she always ambitious, driving?
Nothing stopped her, and yet there was a soft quality about her that I love. You know who's meant a great deal to Betty and was her mother, Ruthie.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, one day we went to the funeral of Ori Kelly, who designed all the lovely clothes for us.
Mm-hmm.
And the crowds were waiting outside the church, and Betty came over to me and took my hand and led me way aside, and she said, look up there at that knoll. Do you see that white headstone? And I said, yes. She said, that's Ruthie. And next to her, the place is all paid for, is where I go, next to Ruthie.
Betty Davis, a practical New Englander, has indeed made all preparations. We've visited the cemetery, a part of Forest Lawn that overlooks the Disney studios and the old Warner Brothers back lot.
I just am glad that it'll be simple. I'll be very near. That's one reason I moved to California. They wouldn't have to take that long trip across the country with me. Here you are, Ruthie, darling. It's Mother's Day. You know what I'm going to have on my tombstone? She did it the hard way.
Betty Davis recorded this song in 1976.
Growing older, feeling younger, what can we do? Time is so fleeting. April fools us, winter rules us, autumn and spring, they have no meeting, love comes along, there is the danger, truth is the mirror, youth is the
stranger, growing older, feeling younger. Why can't time stand still?
Come on.
The trains are gone now. But this little station keeps on working as a constant reminder that business insurance is a two-way track. At Employers of Wausau, our guidance can help you control losses, but your efforts are just as necessary so that, as partners, we can save life and health and property. For business insurance, come to the source, Employers Insurance of Wausau.
Challenge. Create a communications nerve center at Lake Placid, deep in the Adirondacks. Not just phones, but new cables, a new electronic switching system, provisions for multilingual services, and a new light wave and microwave route to transmit television pictures.
Systems operative.
The purpose? To bring you all the excitement of the 1980 Winter Olympics. The Bell System. Keeping your communications system the best in the world.
Monday on WKRP.
Presuppose what happened if you said yes.
Will Jennifer really keep her date with Herb?
You've never let me down before.
Next, on The Last Resort, Zach hears wedding bells.
Can I do your best, man?
Yes!
It's Monday Night Madness, starting at 8, 7 Central.
When Henry's wife left him, she left the kids, the cleaning, the cooking, and the love. Then she wanted them back. Once Upon a Family, Tuesday.
America has been a little short of heroes lately, and with the way the world is going in the last few months, we might need some. The 70s were hard on heroism, but maybe in the 80s, people will start looking for heroes again. If a hero is a man who exemplifies the best in a national character, who is modest and unassuming, who lives in an atmosphere of great valor and hazard, if he is these things, maybe we've found some heroes. Ladies and gentlemen, meet the Thunderbirds.
Woman!
The Thunderbirds, more formally the United States Air Force Demonstration Team, would, of course, deny that they are heroes. That comes with a suit, doesn't it? The Thunderbirds would say instead that they are careful pilots, selected for 2-year stints in an exciting but precise and demanding project, which is essentially to show how good the U.S. Air Force is, to help morale within the force, and to attract young men and women to join up. Lieutenant Colonel D.L. Smith, commander. He flies lead in the Diamond Formation. He had 353 missions over Vietnam. Captain Ron Manus. Ron is left wing in the Diamond. More than 2,300 hours in jet fighters. Captain Jim Latham. He's right wing in the Diamond. Latham was shot down and taken prisoner in one of 328 missions over Vietnam. Major Jim Koziar. He's the slot man. Just behind the leader in the Diamond, 2,700 hours in jet fighters. Captain Gail Scarborough. Scar is lead solo, 150 missions in Vietnam. These days, he seems to spend half his life upside down, as does Captain R.D. Evans, second solo, more than 1,700 hours in jet fighters. Every maneuver in every show or practice flight is rated by a pilot on the ground. And after every flight, there is a debriefing in which, minute by minute of the flight, the pilots criticize each other and themselves.
I think I bottomed before you did, which makes it harder for me to come up and pick you up, too.
Yeah.
Since their origin, the the Thunderbirds 25 years ago, the Thunderbirds and their Navy counterparts, the Blue Angels, have lost 26 pilots in training, in transit, and in air shows. The last casualty was a Navy flyer in November 1978. Something went wrong for a second, and a second is all you've got. But comparing airtime for Thunderbirds and Blue Angels with airtime for all fighter pilots in training, not combat, their casualty rate is low.
People come out to the air shows because it's beautiful and it's precise, but some of them come out also because it looks so darn dangerous.
It's a thing that we say often, but I think we feel safer within that flight with people that we've been working with for a year. Feel safer there than we do in a situation like on a freeway where you don't really know what the fellow next to you is doing or what his condition is.
They are professionals and not daredevils or hot dogs, but they are also quite clearly fighter pilots, members of that breed for which the main qualification is unspoken and vague, but completely understood and recognized by everyone who has it. The Thunderbirds have it, as author Tom Wolfe puts it, the right stuff. These guys unmistakably have the right stuff, and they don't want to fly their precision stunts with any guys who don't have the right stuff.
Thunderbirds, tinch, hut, forward, perch.
Every step and move on the ground or in the air is precisely choreographed. They leave their home base at Nellis Air Force Base in Las Vegas some 153 days a year, and they put on shows. What the Thunderbirds are worth to the U.S. Air Force maybe can best be measured in an air show like this one today at their home base at Nellis Base in Nevada. 250,000 people this year at Cleveland, 250,000 at Fort Worth. Altogether during the season, 5.5 million people come out to see them. Seen them has any question that the $3.5 million or so that the team costs the taxpayers every year is worth it.
Are they worth it to the country, do you think?
You bet.
Yeah.
Now, all right, now, if you had to pay that $3.7 million out of your, I mean, your share of taxes, you're willing?
Well, I pay my share of taxes and everything else.
You got the leader, you got wingmen, you got the slotmen, you got solos. Is there any particular position that's a favorite with the crowd?
I found that everyone loves a slot pilot.
What's your position?
I fly the slot.
You fly the slots.
The reason that we put Jim in the slot position is because it's the one position that I can't watch while we're flying.
Otherwise, you'd get depressed.
That's right. Hi, B.L. Smith.
The birds like to think of themselves as goodwill ambassadors for Air Force and nation. And they are certainly natural-born talents at public relations. Modest, witty, patient with people, either on the flight line or in a hospital. They are always, by necessity, on.
Can you feel your regulated pressure?
One of the things they do is to be nice to journalists. And when they find one who wants to know how things like this feel inside the plane, they help him out. They send him to Andrews Air Force Base for high-altitude flight qualification.
The first time you hear the word bailout, you'd want to go ahead and initiate the ejection.
Then they show him how to save himself if he has to.
The first step of that being assume the proper body position. It's important that you have your elbows tucked in closely to your body and inside those elbow guards. If they were to be over the side, it would conflict with the canopy as the seat came out of the airplane. So it's proper body position, hand grips raise, trigger squeeze, and the parachute would automatically start to come out at that time.
All of this stuff would go away.
Yes, you'd lose it. This whole seat would simply fall to earth.
Be there with just the parachute.
Yes, and you'd be left in the parachute.
And then they take him flying. I spent on three occasions around 4 hours in the second seat. I'm the man in the strange hat. I loved it. When you do what they call the Thunderbird pullout, you live with something like 7 times the force of gravity. It makes you look even funnier than usual, but you can handle it. How you handle it and fly an airplane at the same time is fortunately something I didn't have to worry about. A fellow on the front seat did that. There was very little fear, a lot of thrill, very little fear. It is careful and precise and relaxed, as the calm voices on the interplane radio show.
boys just cruising right along, being cool. We're gonna fly through the air with the greatest of ease. Well, we're all going out to have some fun. Doodah, doodah.
Heroes? Probably. After all, heroes are supposed to make others who share their nationality and culture feel good. These guys make you feel good.
Midtown.
The one by United Industries.
The one by the headquarters or the plant?
The headquarters.
We offer you a choice of the most popular locations.
You need three hands.
You're right.
People-pleasing locations.
The airport?
The one by Holiday Inn North or Holiday Inn South?
Is number one in people-pleasing.
I shopped around before I came to Midas. I went to this gas station and said, is your bargain muffler guaranteed? He says,
then it wouldn't be a bargain.
So I went to another station and said, is your bargain muffler guaranteed? He says,
what's the matter, pal? Don't you trust me?
What looked like a bargain was no bargain. Midas gave me a good price and a guarantee. If anything goes wrong, they replace my muffler free as long as I own my car. It pays to Midas size.
"60 Minutes," a CBS News weekly magazine, will continue.
Monday on MASH, the camp is in chaos when Hawkeye temporarily takes command.
Hawk, the only order you've given in 2 days is for a double scotch.
Then on House Calls, the staff is quarantined in the cafeteria where the food is cold and the tempers are hot.
You take requests?
Of course.
I cannot take!
MASH, then House Calls, Monday at 9, 8 Central.
Tomorrow on CBS.
The IBM Series 3. A copier duplicator that does it all.
KCMO-TV, Kansas City, Missouri.
Valari Special is a six-passenger car with automatic transmission, power steering, radio tires that sells for less than $5,000. We engineer basic value into Plymouth.
Even with all that equipment, this Valari Special is sticker price $800 less than its closest six-passenger competition. $800. Anybody ask you what happened to the reasonably priced, good gas mileage family car, tell them it's called Plymouth Valari.
I'm not asking you to buy any car on faith. I'm asking you to compare.
I'm Cheryl Teague. I feel at home in front of the camera. But behind the camera, I don't know the difference between a lens opening and a Broadway opening. So I rely on my Olympus OM-10. My trusty OM-10 gets great shots automatically. My OM-10 has the smart little red light that tells me when it's okay to shoot. Oh, it's okay to shoot. Hold it, fellas! With Olympus OM-10, great shots automatically.
PDAP, PDAP, stands for the Palmer Drug Abuse Program, born 8 years ago in the basement of Houston's Palmer Episcopal Church. Few people outside of Texas had ever heard of PDAP until People magazine reported that Carrie Hamilton, the 15-year-old daughter of TV star Carol Burnett and producer Joe Hamilton, had become a drug addict and that her parents had sent Carrie to PDAP, where she kicked her habit. Carol Burnett and her husband Joe Hamilton went on Dinah and Donahue and other talk shows to extol the drug and alcohol abuse program and to praise its founder and leader, a former addict and cured alcoholic named Bob Meehan. Now, some see Mr. Meehan as a miracle worker, bringing God and clean living back into young people's lives. Others say he gets those youngsters dependent on him and PDAP in place of their former dependence on drugs and alcohol. Meehan himself leaves no doubt that he has found the answer. His message is, do it my way or leave.
Now, I'm saying this program works for a group of people. If it doesn't work for you, try another one. Don't tell me to change this one because it's already working for this group of people. It's my way or it's the highway. Go find another program. There are 22 Mickey Mouse programs running around in our area. Go to one of them. You don't have to stay. We're not keeping you here. You're not in chains. You walk the doors. You live at home. You go to school. You know, we're not controlling you in any way, shape, or form. You don't like it? Leave.
PDAP operates in meeting rooms donated by more than 30 churches in Houston, has branches in 9 other Texas cities, and Denver, Colorado, and starting next month in Los Angeles. There are no membership fees. The $2.5 million budget is raised from the community through an increasingly necessary fundraising campaign. It is not a residential program. Youngsters live at home or on their own, except for a small number from out of town like Kerry Hamilton, who stay with volunteer families. A substantial number may spend a month or more in a PDAP-affiliated hospital. PDAP is a drug-oriented, youth-oriented version of Alcoholics Anonymous. The members go to meetings, day meetings, night meetings, even a few times a year, 24-hour meetings. No drugs, no alcohol, as little contact as possible with anyone who uses either. It preaches a way of life, and that outside the chosen path lies disaster. Bob Meehan is convinced it works.
You people, all of you, saw more sober kids at one time than you have ever seen in your lives. At this age group, and in any group. I don't care if it's a church group, I don't care where it is, there are people getting loaded there. There's nothing like this on this size that exists anywhere, and believe me, I've looked for it.
This is my 29th day sobriety.
The program's tools are peer pressure and peer support, laced with a heavy dose of getting yourself right with God, with others, and with yourself. All of it encouraged and directed by a staff of PDAP-trained and paid counselors who are themselves ex-drug abusers.
It's real easy to get into a negative place. You know, so what we do up here is we learn how to be positive. Does anybody want to share?
Members are told to steer clear of non-members and to attend as many meetings as they can. Meetings which combine the kind of public confessional popular in certain churches with a dose of amateur group therapy.
And yesterday, I was in a car accident. I wrecked the only material thing I had that meant anything to me, my car. It was the only thing I had that could get me to California. And I just sat in the car, and I wasn't angry, when normally I would be angry for what happened. And I didn't want to go get high. For the first time in my life, I did not want to get high. As far as I'm concerned, this is my first day here, because this is the first day I'm giving 100%. I led a meeting yesterday on risk, and I haven't been willing to take that risk. I haven't been willing. I have thousands of people in PDAP that love me, and they don't even know me, some of them. And I'm willing to give it all. I'm finally willing.
Some of these PDAP members are well into their 20s, but much younger drug users, some only 11 or 12, attend other meetings.
I've been having a lot of problems because I didn't admit that my changing chemicals have messed up at least part of my life. And I know that they have because I'd been stealing from my brother, doing anything just to get high, you know.
At just about every meeting, someone gets a monkey fist, a braided leather ball at the end of a leather necklace.
Get a 30 days fist by staying straight. 30 days consecutively in a row.
Yeah. Kids who already have their fist bear witness.
You just came in my life at a real special time. You know, you kind of replaced the void that I was feeling. And I've just watched you grow a whole lot. You're real special to me, and I really like having a little brother. I love you. Yeah.
When one walks in the doors, he must think that anybody that takes a drink, smokes a joint, is a complete loser. Pick winners is the name. Pick people that you respect, that you look up to, that offer you a way of life that you think you'd like.
See if you can get me Larry Layden.
Bob Meehan is a winner. From the depths of drunkenness and addiction, he has risen to head a multi-million dollar program with a paid staff of more than 300 ex-addicts. judges, ministers, company presidents sit on his boards of directors and contribute to his program.
Come down to Houston town. Find what you've been dreaming of.
He has formed a rock group from among his members, and while PDAP youngsters are discouraged, even forbidden, to attend other rock concerts, they are encouraged to buy tickets to the occasional appearances of Freeway. The music isn't all that good, but there is something refreshing about a rock concert not overwhelmed by the pungent smell of burning marijuana. Meehan's income has risen as his program has grown, from nearly nothing to more than $100,000 a year in salary from PDAP and from consultant fees from hospitals and corporations as an advisor on drug abuse and its cure. And he says he's worth it.
I have a great head. I know more about this problem than anybody I know. I'm the most together person I know. And if anybody wants to know what to do about the problem in a business, they consult with me. They're going to get the right answers. And I am very expensive. If I wasn't making money, you wouldn't be here today, partner.
May we have a few moments of silence?
Parents, too, are part of PDAP. Something less than half the parents whose kids are in the program are active. In PDAP parlance, these are the good parents. They also support the organization financially. Parents give 80% of the cost of PDAP. The other 20% comes from donations from corporations and foundations.
God, I love y'all. I love
you. Does the program work? Do the kids get off drugs and stay off? Meehan and his colleagues have repeatedly said that they are 75 to 80% successful. But when they are pressed, they say that those figures refer only to the percentage of kids who stay straight for 30 days and get their monkey fist. And when Meehan is pressed further, even that doesn't hold up too well.
First of all, let's take a criteria for success, which is where the general public gets so confused. To me, I've been on methadone. I tell parents that if you want your child on methadone, great. You always wanted a vegetable garden anyway. Put them in a backyard, a little dirt around their feet, they'll be on hold till they die. See, but everybody sits around saying, well, at least they won't steal my color TV. Wrong. They're loaded for that whole year that they keep their stats on them, okay? And they're considered a success. What is success? What are we going to use as a definition for success? To me, it's one who has become a dues-paying member of society, has returned to school, no longer has a chemical problem, okay? Is moving on to enjoy life to its fullest and being part of what you and I consider society. In that area, we are more successful than anybody I know of. What about the bottom line dry statistics? Fine. Mr. Rather, 60 Minutes, if you care to give me $75,000 to do that kind of study and hire the statisticians necessary to do it, I will.
Are you saying to me that you don't have any data to back up your claim that you're 75 to 80% successful?
We have, the data we have is quite different from data anybody else has. And see, we don't keep records on people. If your children came to us, they don't have to give us their right name. They want help, they stay, they don't, they leave.
Pardon me for interrupting, but that's part of the problem.
Again, I find that an absolutely astonishing
thing that you would say, Mr. Rather, I don't even know the names of most people who come into our place.
We're not here for names. We're here to show people a better way to live.
Okay, but
you want it, stay. You don't leave.
You can't give me a figure. These are the numbers of people that we had come through our doors.
We don't have the time. We get 400 calls a day from all over the world.
Okay, but you don't know how many are coming through the door.
No.
So how can you say you're 75 to 80% successful?
Because of the times that I ran groups, I knew when I knew the kids in the group, when I saw how many came in, when I was running a group myself, I saw how many came in, and I knew what it was.
Mr. Bean, I don't doubt for a moment that you did that, but when you boil it down, what you've got is a guess.
Oh, definitely. Oh, you're right. Definitely a guess.
Okay, so when you say you're 75 to 80% effective, you're guessing.
I'd like to say 70.
Let's say 70. Yeah. Let's take a conservative figure. Do you consider that to be conservative?
No, conservative, 65 to 70.
All right, 65 to 70.
Okay.
I note that we're already down from 75 to 80% down to 65 to 70.
You haven't talked to me.
All right, you say 65 to 70. But I say, is that your guess as to how effective
that's
you are?
That's my guess.
We talked to someone in Dallas who was very complimentary about the program. But they noted that in Dallas, that your people had said they had 2,000 PDAP members in the Dallas area. But when they actually got down to counting heads, it turned out to be 500. Is that true?
Very true.
You can understand how someone in my position, trying to be an honest broker of information, would come away with at least the impression
Number one, their success figures are inflated. Number two, their overall membership figures are inflated.
Yes, sir.
But it's not the truth.
It's really not.
Your success figures are 65 to 70%?
At least. At least.
If Meehan's figures on how many come in, how many stay, and how many actually kick the habit or wobbly, that makes equally suspect his statement to us that he only spends an average $500 per year per member. And that dollar amount doesn't even include the huge hospital costs of an estimated 550 youngsters referred last year by PDAP to this hospital and other hospitals run by the same management company, a company which pays Bob Meehan $50,000 a year as a consultant. Average length of stay in the hospital, 4 to 6 weeks. Average cost, at least $10,000 per youngster. That's not paid by PDAP. It's paid by parents and medical insurance. That alone is twice the entire PDAP budget. In the hospital, the PDAP patients get biofeedback, psychotherapy, and other medical treatment. Few of them need detoxification. But what they also get is a concentrated dose of PDAP. PDAP counselors, whose salary is paid indirectly by the hospital, hold PDAP meetings daily, and they treat and manage patients right along with the more highly trained staff. Are all these youngsters really sick enough or addicted enough to need to be hospitalized? Susie Waters was a PDAP counselor at the hospital for 5 months last year.
I think that the reason why most of those people were in there was so we could make a big impression on them right from the beginning. It's a way of isolating them to only get PDAP from the very front. It was the troublemakers that ended up in the hospital. It was the people that wouldn't go by the normal rules, that wouldn't stick with winners, or that wouldn't stop going to concerts. It was the troublemakers that ended up there. And a lot of them were just little kids. You know, they were just out having fun. I remember thinking a lot of times, why is this person here? You know, they weren't, I was just the same as a lot of them.
The hospital management flatly denies that the PDAP patients they admitted didn't need the medical treatment they got. And they said the consultant fee they paid Bob Meehan was for his advice on drug abuse and had nothing to do with the fact that PDAP referred so many patients. Meehan couldn't see the connection either.
And they pay you $50,000 a year?
At this time.
What do you mean at this time?
Well, I plan to tell them I'm worth a lot more because they've made an awful lot of money at what they, because they listened to me, and I think I'm worth more.
Right on the surface of it, there is a conflict of interest. On the one hand, you sit at the top of the PDAP pyramid. On the other hand, you have a personal service contract with a hospital for whom you are directly, not just in effect, directly supplying patients.
No, sir, I am not. The counselors that work for me are going to put their patients, or are going to refer to hospitals that they think are doing the best job.
You don't see a conflict of interest?
I really don't.
Bob Meehan is just sits on the right hand of God to most of those people. And to me at one time, that's the way I looked at him.
Bob Gaffney was a staff counselor for PDAP. He spent 5 years in the group. This man, who asked that we not give his name, was in PDAP 4 years, rising to the high staff post of director of the Dallas branch.
Does the Palmer drug abuse program prepare these young people for reality?
No. As a matter of fact, we're led to believe that we can't make it without the program, which I think is one of the greatest disservices that's done to anybody that goes through the program, because I think many people who leave, who naturally leave, and who could be considered successes of the program, basically fail because the message is there: I cannot succeed without these people and without this program.
Is that what is sold on the inside from Bob Meehan right on down?
Yes.
That you cannot succeed without the program?
Yes.
Well, that makes it never ending.
Yes.
They are two of dozens of former PDAP staff members with whom we spoke. They are all sober and straight and feel the program helped them. But equally, they feel the program has serious flaws.
Power has become as intoxicating to some people as perhaps drugs were several years ago.
By some people, do you mean me and specifically?
Yes.
I don't even like power. I am a powerful person. That is this personal power.
Well, among the strongest powers is the power to persuade.
That's right. I have that power. I certainly do. I've been a con all my life. I just now I'm using it in a good way. See, that's the only difference. People come into me and want to sober up. I don't say, they say, boy, it hurts when you do that. I don't say, don't do that. Right? They come in and they try act cool and say, hey, don't come in here acting cool. Cool people never get to see me, Padna. You know, cool people out there making it. So don't come in here telling me you're cool. You know, you got problems, you wouldn't be here. Mama didn't bring you in by the back of your neck because you're cool. That's a con. It's using words he's going to understand. It's communicating. What is my purpose? To get him to think for himself, to be his own man, and make him see where he really is. In that way, I am powerful.
They don't look at it like you're coming into this program to recover and move on. They look at it like you have stepped into a better way of life than everybody else in the world has. That's the problem. And if you want to leave, you know, there's something wrong with you. Bob, I think, thought that I was really going to be in the gutter with a needle in my arm or something because I was leaving, you know? And they really think that way. You know, to them, when you get to PDAP, you have arrived.
It comes down that major decisions in people's lives, you know, continuing education, getting a job, getting married, going steady, all involve other people and what they think about it. Basically, you can lead your whole life in the program and never have to make a decision except that you're going to let somebody else make decisions for you.
That's a lie. It's very upsetting. I don't know if these people are getting high again and have a need to somehow knock us. I don't know what their situation is. I think if you go and talk to some of the people that are making it and doing fine, you'll hear another story. But remember, they're out there making it. They're not sitting around chewing on my tail. They're doing their thing. They don't have time to sit around and talk to 60 Minutes because they're trying to stay on the dean's list. You're going to have to hunt them down. Well, you don't have time to hunt them down. So who do you pick on? The losers that are lurked around hoping to get on 60 Minutes.
Well, I gather that you're concerned about the line of questioning.
Oh, yes.
Why?
It's my baby. It's my baby. I know that everything that happens here is the most positive, one of the most positive moving forces in this whole nation today. I know that. Without a doubt in my mind. I know that just from the shows we did with Carol Burnett and some people, the calls that we've gotten, that people finally took back control of their homes, told their children love does not mean accepting wrong behavior, threw the dope out, took some hot positive moves in this country that haven't been done in years. You know, I know what we're doing. My problem is, and my mistake is, I've gotten too successful.
The extent of that success will have to await a less self-serving analysis. Unquestionably, there are a number of youngsters who have given up drugs and alcohol with PDAP's help, and we have met some of them. Just as unquestionably, a number have gone back to getting high, and no one really knows what either of those numbers are. As for young Carrie Hamilton, she's still straight and drug-free, and last week she went home to her parents in Los Angeles.
The horizon is it's a car of today, it's a car of tomorrow. It's really a leader.
The Horizon is one of the best engineered small cars in the market.
It sounds like those Chrysler engineers are bragging, but the fact is, Horizon has more passenger room than Pinto or Chevette, more cargo space, good gas mileage, proven front-wheel drive. That's not bragging. That's just how it is.
We're building Horizons day and night, so you can take delivery of these great mileage cars right now at your Chrysler Plymouth dealer.
Where will you be when your mouthwash stops working?
My first day on the job. Bad breath. Should have used Listerine.
Listerine Strong to work long, hours longer than the number two mouthwash. While Listerine will not help prevent colds or sore throats or lessen their severity, its strong formula keeps breath clean hours longer, kills the germs that can cause bad breath.
Great sales. Great salesperson.
Listerine Antiseptic works hours longer.
In the beginning, there was Super Bowl I, Roman I. Tonight, there was Super Bowl XIV. A year from now, there'll be Super Bowl XV, and on and on and on. But for the moment, there is nothing.
Could I ask a little favor of some of you tonight? Please don't sit there saying you hate football and you're glad it's over. Don't say that. Some of us are very sad. There's a hole in our lives you could drive a truck through, as Frank Gifford might say. Be kind to those of us who love football as we go through these agonizing weeks of withdrawal. Don't start out right away with saying cruel things. You know, things like, you can unfasten your seatbelt now, dear, the games are over. Or, you remember your children, don't you? This is Donald. He turned 9 while you were gone. No one who has just lost a close friend wants to hear smart aleck remarks. Just be patient and try to help us. We're going to be okay. In another month or so, we'll be able to sit up and take food again at the dining room table instead of in front of the tube in the living room. We have a stack of Sunday papers we never got to read, but we have until next fall now to catch up on them. Next fall starts with a first preseason game on August 8th. We'll be back in touch with the world again pretty soon, too. Pat Summerall mentioned Jimmy Carter during the halftime show a few weeks ago. He is still president, isn't he? Be patient with us now that football's over.
That brings us to the mail and some more thoughts about football. About our story last week on football injuries, one viewer said, "People who go to football games and encourage defensive tackles to cream offensive backs remind me of the crazy Romans who enjoyed seeing helpless people being torn to death by lions." During that story, Terry Bradshaw and Rocky Blyer criticized AstroTurf by name, which prompted Monsanto, which makes and trademarks AstroTurf, to write and say, "AstroTurf was improperly used as the generic term for artificial turf, when in fact there are several manufacturers' products installed in NFL stadiums. For instance, the Pittsburgh Steelers play at home on a competitive product." About Commissioner Pete Rozelle's contention that artificial turf is being used on football fields because it enables stadium owners to use the field for other activities, a viewer wrote, "I suspect the real reason they want artificial turf is because their uniforms don't get dirty, and that presents a much neater image to television." And what did viewers think about our story on presidential candidate George Bush? You pays your money and you takes your choice. One viewer said, "I don't know what your motive was in attempting to put down George Bush, but you were clumsy and obvious about it." Another viewer watching that same story said, "It was the most inspiring, the most gratifying story I have yet seen on television about a presidential candidate." Finally, about our story on Americans who avoid paying taxes by keeping their income off the books, there was this: "When taxes are perceived as oppressive, the populace does what the government refuses to do: lower them themselves." And about the yacht owner who doesn't pay taxes and said he would sail away to the Bahamas if the IRS came after him, a viewer said, "Tell that guy to get in his boat, go out to the Bahamas, and take all those other tax evaders with him. Then the rest of us won't have to pay their tab along with our own." I'm Morley Safer. We'll be back next week with another edition of 60 Minutes.
Ooh, that's not just an ordinary Valentine.
Is it anyone we know?
Well, whatever he said, he sure made her day.
Only Hallmark has 1,442 ways to say, "Be my Valentine." And one of them is your way.
Hey, what a card can say for you. Hey, what a Hallmark card can do.
We've cushioned Cordova's ride with thick rubber mounts at all suspension points.
Our patented transverse front suspension keeps Cordova's ride luxurious.
Cordova. To drive it is to experience the pleasure of a truly roadworthy automobile in the Chrysler tradition of luxury. Yes, even rich Corinthian leather. Chrysler engineering achieves fuel economy for the times. Styling in timeless good taste. You owe yourself a ride in this new, smaller Chrysler. Cordova. I like what they've done to my car.
Tuesday on The White Shadow, Coach Reeves is invited to play a round of golf at a fancy club, and he takes Salami, Thorpe, and Coolidge with him. It's a howl-in-one for The White Shadow Tuesday night. Then on Wednesday, George Burns hosts the 10th annual Entertainer of the Year award show, Wednesday night on CBS.
We Americans have seen the light, and we're putting it out. For the latest on smoking and quitting,
write Smoke Watch, Rockville, Maryland, 20857.
Wednesday, Telly Savalas and Linda Carter host the 6th Annual International Circus Festival of Monte Carlo. The best circus acts from all over the world. Wednesday at 8, 7 Central. Thursday, Marriott Hartley and Burt Parks host the People's Choice Awards. As the American public awards its favorite stars, TV shows, movies, and music. Thursday at 9, 8 Central.
This is CBS.
Does the high cost of energy make you feel like you're burning money to heat your house? Well, there's something you can do about it.
Tighten up.
And turn it down.
Tighten up.
And turn it down.
Tighten up.
Turn it down.
And enjoy the savings.
Energy, we can't afford to waste it.
Jim Rockford, private investigator.
Jim Garner is Jim Rockford, Monday through Thursday at 10:30 here on TV5.
From the TV5 News Center, this is Eyewitness News Break for Sunday.
Good evening. President Carter on Meet the Press today announced he is asking the U.S. Olympic Committee to boycott the Olympics unless Russia withdraws from Afghanistan within 1 month. On Issues and Answers, Senator Ted Kennedy said he would support the boycott, but Carter's Iowa primary opponent says he will not withdraw from the race for president despite declining polls. Join Steve Dawson and me for all the news at 10.
KCMO-TV, Kansas City, Missouri.
Surrounded. Charlie's got us surrounded.
Is Charlie someone you know?
Yeah, just mine.
Paralyzed.
From the waist down.
Oh, dear. That's my favorite half.
He's expecting you to work on him, but since you refuse, then you can be the one to tell him why. This is one job I sure as hell won't do for you.
Give him enough time. That guy's like a time bomb in there.
Next time it could be you or a kid.
Get down!
John, M.D., sponsored by Prudential. Life, health, auto, and home insurance are available from a Prudential agent. Get a piece of the rock. Prudential Insurance.
And now, some lucky member of our studio audience gets a chance to win it all. So come on up, Mrs. Jean Leonard.
Prudential wishes your wildest dreams come true.
Jean Leonard, it's your chance. Pick the right door and you win it all.
Oh, my gosh, here comes college for the kids. No more work for us. I pick green. No, red. Red. No, green. Green. Green.
Not green, Jean. But you did win dinner for two at Gershenbaum Chateau Hawaiian in downtown Burbank.
Prudential wishes you luck. But for something you can really count on, get a piece of the rock.
Prudential Life Insurance. It can help pay for college, retirement, things your family needs, even if you're not around. Last year, Prudential paid more benefits than any other life insurance company.
Kirschenbaum Chateau Hawaiian?
For life, health, auto, home.
Yeah, it's a rock.
Prudential Insurance.
Now, a poet's nervous system is a finely tuned precision instrument. You're not supposed to just...
Easy, sir. Remember your heart. Shall we?
Who sat in that thing before me? Some decomposing derelict with a bell around his neck?
Yes, sir, but the bell was very clean. Can I help you?
I am not traveling in that vomitous vehicle. At these prices, I should have a gilded sedan chair with six Nubian slaves.
Hospital rule, sir. If we don't wheel you out, you don't leave at all.
Giddy app.
The guy is a genius.
I mean it, John. They should give him a Nobel Prize.
I don't give a Nobel Prize in accounting.
Anyway, all my tax problems are solved. I'm no longer Stanley Riverside MD. I'm now Stanley Riverside Inc., a medical corporation.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
It's really a wonderful opportunity, John.
Leaving, Mr. Jennings?
Not a moment too soon.
So we'll be diversifying, see? We'll be getting into real estate, for example. This may sound far out to you, but how about an amusement park with a medical theme? Instead of having a roller coaster, we could have a car rocketing through a giant replica of a human gullet. Hmm? All the thrills and spills of the Alimentary Canal. Isn't that great?
Just don't tell me the big finish.
Hey, Trevor.
Oh, good morning, Doctor.
I've been looking for you.
If you don't mind, Dr. Gates. Anyway, John, the point of all this is that I need officers for my corporation. See, I'll be president, of course, and Dad will be secretary treasurer, but we need a vice president to make it legal. How about it?
Sorry, Stanley, I'm just not the executive type.
You need a vice president, Stanley. I'm available.
Please. My vice president at least would wear a tie.
Stop! Listen to me! Listen to me!